that, I will call the Prior Lake Savage Area School Board board meeting to order. We'll start out with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All members are present tonight, and with that, I will seek a motion for approval of the agenda. By Ben, do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Stacy. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. That passes 7-0. Next on the agenda, agenda for this evening is the consent agenda. Consent agenda items are considered to be routine in nature and will be enacted by one motion. There will be no separate discussion of these items unless a board member or citizen so requests, in which event that item will be removed from the consent agenda and addressed. Do I have a motion for the acceptance of the consent agenda?
So moved.
By Mary. Do I have a second?
Second.
By Lee. All those in favor say aye.
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 Oh, that passes 7-0. Next on the agenda is the resolution of the acceptance of gifts. And forgive me here. We have one gift this evening from Boy Scout Troop 331. Do I have a motion for the acceptance of the gifts from the Boy Scout Troop 331?
So moved.
By Todd. Do I have a second?
Second.
By Melissa. All those in favor? Or, excuse me, this is a resolution, so it requires a roll call vote. Ben?
Aye.
Melissa?
Aye.
Stacy?
Aye.
Lee?
Aye.
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 That passes 7-0. Next item on the agenda, we have no Laker Pride or special recognition for this evening. Next on the agenda is personal items. And with that, I'll hand it over to Executive Director of Human Resources, Mr. Mons.
Thank you very much. Good evening, members of the board and Dr. Stallo. First up this evening, I would like to recommend the following candidates for employment and am seeking board approval. A quick note before taking the vote. We have both our new Glendale Elementary principal on this list this evening. That's Jennifer Molitor, coming to us from Faribault, where she currently serves as an elementary principal. And she was not able to make it here this evening. However, she will be joining us before our August board meeting so that you'll all get a chance to greet Ms. Molitor. And then this evening, we do have Mark Paulson with us, who is our new assistant principal at the high school. And I am, after the vote's taken, going to ask him to just come up briefly and introduce himself to the board.
Okay, with that, do I have a motion for the acceptance of the candidates for employment?
So moved.
By Lee, do I have a second?
Second.
By Todd. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That passes 7-0.
Mark, if you want to come up and introduce yourself, that would be great.
Good evening. I am Mark Paulson, new AP at the high school. And when I was first offered the job and hired, Matt actually asked if I'd be willing to come and introduce myself. And I said, sure, and I wasn't really quite sure what you'd want to know. But I'm now really grateful to have this time because I just want to share with you all that I've been here for a week. And I left my previous district after 19 years of service there as a teacher and instructional coach in Atossa. And I have to say, it was very hard to leave 19 years of friendships and relationships. But in my week that I've been here, I have to tell you that everybody from Deborah in HR, who laughed with me all the way through the third explanation of the health benefits, to Joe and Ann and Dr. Bezik, and I'm sorry, I knew the head custodian's name, but then the secretary called him Pork Chop, and that just went straight to long-term memory. So I'm going to go back to that name. But I just have to say, at every turn, people have been welcoming, supportive, and has made this transition really easy for me. And I'm very excited and honored to be a part of this team, and I'm really looking forward to contributing however I can. But real quick background, 19 years in education, 15 in the classroom, instructional coach, for a couple of years, and then as a TOSA at the District Center doing curriculum and technology integration work. So that's my kind of educational professional background. But I just wanted to share again, it's been really tremendous, the time that I've, even just the week I've been here. And it's a great community. I'm really excited about what the future holds for me. So
thank you.
Yep.
Thank you. Welcome to Prior Lake Savage Area Schools, and we look forward to seeing more of you. Next on the agenda is the approval of the leaves of absence.
Yes.
Or leaves requests.
Next up, I present the following leaves of absence, and I'm seeking board approval.
Do I have a motion for the approval of the leave requests?
So moved.
By Ben. Do I have a second?
Second.
By Stacy. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed? That passes 7-0.
And next up, we do have a certified staffing request this evening. This is for a 0.4 addition to our elementary specialist staffing. And where this stems from essentially is with the number of classroom sections that we've added. Sometimes the pieces just don't quite fit because, for instance, you can't have a music teacher teaching four classes concurrently at four different elementary schools. And so when those puzzle pieces don't fit perfectly, what we result with is a little bit of additional need in order to round that out to make sure that we've got the right professional working with our students. And so with that, we do have a 0.4 increase. I apologize, the language surrounding the need for this position is not quite right. This does not correspond to a particular three-section increase. This corresponds to the natural increase that we see as we try to build that master specialist schedule.
Okay. Do I have a motion for the acceptance of the additional staffing?
So moved.
By Mary, do I have a second?
Second.
By Lee, are there any questions? I have one. Which school is this person? Is this new?
This is a whole lot of positions at a whole lot of schools. So okay. Some of these bits of FTE could be as small as a 0.03 to a 0.06 even. So this is really just kind of rounding out those positions to make sure that we're covered. It's possible that we could see a little bit of additional need in the future, but I think this should get us into the school year. Without coming back for an additional request. That's the hope.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? That passes 7-0.
All right, next up we have an educational support staff request, and this is for a new full-time child nutrition services assistant manager position at Edgewood. This is the position that will run that satellite kitchen on the Edgewood side for that combo food service arrangement that we have between Westwood and Edgewood. And so we did some of that on a long-term substitute basis to understand what the needs were in that kitchen. And now we've really understood what those needs are, and we're bringing this request forward for the 17-18 school year.
So do I have a motion to accept the additional staffing for the educational support staff?
So moved.
By Lee, do I have a second?
Second.
By Ben, are there any questions? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? That passes 7-0. We move on to unfinished business. The financial overview of the facilities projects scope components. It has in my agenda, Dr. Stallo will be presenting with Assistant Superintendent Holberg.
And actually, there is a change to that. Yes.
Okay.
First of all, a couple changes. That title really is just an update to the community and certainly the board members. It's a review of the facilities planning process. Mr. Holmberg is unable to be here this evening, and Ehlers also is not here, but myself and Executive Director Julie Sink will be tagging this presentation. The importance of this presentation is to ensure that our community is updated with where the board is with our process, especially in light of later in the agenda, we'll be seeking approval on the MDE review and comment. We'll see if the clicker works from here.
You're going to drive from here.
I am, maybe.
Hopefully.
Or Julie's going to help me drive, I think. The work in which the board has been engaged remains grounded and seeking a space solution for our growing student enrollment, which upholds our strategic plan and the quality programming that we have promised to our community. This is just a review of the timeline, and you can see the multiple meetings that have taken place since May 8th, when the Facilities Task Force recommendations were approved as input to the school board. Since that time, board members have spent many hours reviewing the scope of the projects and have worked to reduce the tax impact to community members through reduction of projects, as well as utilizing additional financial options. Over the past several weeks, the school board has also reviewed and discussed options for increased operating revenue. Just as a reminder, although the board's been working really hard for the last several weeks and months, the process began long before the recommendations from the Facilities Task Force came to the board in early May. Last fall, the board directed administration to convene a community group to study the facility needs and to bring forward recommendations for space solutions for student programming. The 50-member community group began meeting in December to review data, assess needs, and to bring forward recommendations for approval in May. And this is just a review of all of those meetings that took place. The board timeline, each meeting, and we just included, for our community members especially, we just included the outcomes of each of those meetings so that the community can have a chance to take a look at what was accomplished at each of those meetings and how we really had that timeline laid out so that the work could get done throughout the process. We even added an additional study session on June 21st that was set to be a board development date, but we wanted the additional time to ensure that we were able to review the scope of the projects and make sure there was enough time for discussion and the clarification in order for the board to provide direction on financial decisions for the review and comment that, as I said, we will seek approval on later this evening. Along with the strategic plan, board members approved this guiding change document, which was used by the Facilities Task Force and has continually been reviewed and confirmed by the school board. The board's been working on a 10-year facility solution, which would provide the core space expansion, 21st century learning space, spaces for art, music, and technology, co-curricular space for balanced opportunities. We want to be sure everything is aligned to the strategic plan and that it serves all programs, and that there's adequate space for instructional, operations, co-curricular, athletics, early childhood, and kids company. Additional facilities are needed because most of our buildings are currently at or over capacity for teaching spaces as outlined on this chart. As you recall, the red indicates those spaces that are 100% or more at capacity. And the yellow is those that are nearing that 100% capacity throughout the district. The next chart is another chart that we have shown several times, but just as a reminder to our public, according to our latest demographic study conducted by Hazel Reinhart, 2,165 additional students are anticipated over the next 10 years. And Julie, I'm going to ask for your help on this because I don't recall exactly, but I know you've done a little historical review on the past 17 years.
Right. Since the year 2000, our school district has grown an average of 229 students per year. And so I think we reflected it in the previous slide at the bottom. So we are growing and we will continue. There's nothing that shows in our demographics that we won't continue with the space that we have available in our district.
Thank you. The next slide just reviews again, you know, as the board has been working, we've been talking both about bonds for building and levies for learning, two different funding sources. And as we continue moving forward, we're sure to help educate our community about the differences, how some monies and some revenues are only allowed for certain things. But bonds really are for those buildings, for construction, for additions to our schools, and the levies for learning is the money that's needed to operate those schools. I'm going to review where we are with the bond piece, and then Julie's going to talk a little bit about the operating levy. So the board has worked, as I said, hours and hours and hours in the last several weeks. to find a solution that meets the needs of our district while reducing the impact to taxpayers on a bond. They have been able to reduce the actual bond from, which started at about $128 million, to today it sits at $110 million. The referendum projects would provide space for the projected enrollment for the first several years and provide flexibility for future bonds to add classrooms as needed, utilizing lease levy at that point. The board has provided direction to maintain a centralized pre-K focus with referendum projects that would add classroom additions to five of our buildings. We would build a new elementary school, new facility for Bridges Area Learning Center, physical education classroom space at Prior Lake High School, food service additions and renovations to five of the schools, and other renovations throughout the district. Ultimately, the goals of the bond project would provide capacity needed for additional students at each level, core space as needed, and to ensure appropriate learning spaces for all of our programs. And these were just part of the goals of the building bond project that were outlined. As part of the process, the board utilized other financial options to determine ways to complete some of the projects while reducing the scope of the bond referendum. Many projects remain in the bond referendum. However, board members directed some of the projects to be completed with capital dollars or long-term facilities maintenance dollars. In addition, board members prioritize building space for the immediate future while also providing flexibility for future boards to add space as needed. As I said before, with lease levy to fulfill the scope of the original 10-year facilities plan, which the task force had requested that we build out a 10-year plan instead of a previous 5-year plan.
I know that you have seen, or good evening, I know that you have seen this before, and I think it is a good review for us always to look at that we are one of the lowest districts surrounding us with an operating referendum at 673, and that brings in about $6.4 million into our district. So it's important that we find a way to renew that so that continues on for another 10 years, as you know, as we voted on in 2008. And you can see by the red line that that's the technology levies that districts surrounding us have. And besides us, the only other district that does not have a technology levy is Farmington. So when you combine the two, we're one of the lowest around with the two options, including the tech levy and the operating, for additional money that comes into our district. And I do think if you look at the bottom, the seven county metro average currently for FY18 is 1,022. And so you can see we're significantly below that. And I think that we can look at our comparison and you can see that we're one of the lowest, as we're number 260 out of 331 school districts in terms of the revenue that we receive. The only one that's lower than us is Shakopee. However, they do not receive some of the QCOMP funding that we do receive. And so they are a little bit lower than us. As it stands right now, and I can't speak for all the other schools as they ask for additional operating as well, but if we were to pass what we're suggesting later in the slide is 250, that would just barely put us above Farmington where they sit right now. And so our assumptions for looking at additional operating referendum, and we're looking at for a duration of 10 years with approximately 320, and I think it's reduced now to 300,000 square feet of district space, enrollment assumptions that you saw earlier in the presentation. We're assuming a 2% increase of funding from the state of Minnesota and the special education per statute. And I put that in there because we are at our limit for special education funding currently. Our long-term facility maintenance funding per statute and maintaining the teaching staff and ratios, student staff to student ratios at all levels, including teaching and all other clerical administration, special ed, instructional support, maintaining all of those ratios. Increasing our custodial staffing due to the additional square footage and our maintenance staff, because we will need additional maintenance on those buildings as well. Increasing our utility costs for that space. We have some needs for additional technology, so we're allocating some dollars for that as well. and maintaining that technology staffing ratio. We will have additional bus costs because of our additional students and adding a building, proposed new elementary school. And then trying to maintain our fund balance within the 8 to 12%, which is the district's policy. And so if you look at the numbers, we would increase it $250 from $673.97 to $923.97. If you remember, it currently that seven county metro average is 1,022, so we'd be $100 below that average. Again, it's 10 years. The operating cap that a district could ask for right now is 1,936, so we're less than half of the maximum, and it would bring in about almost $8.4 million into the district for operating. So for the new school, the new spaces. And the next slide compares our school property taxes on a $300,000 home for Prior Lake Savage Schools to eight other school districts. And we're comparing 2 years, 2010 to 2017. And this is what it looks like. And you can see our district is the only district that's declining. So what they're comparing is a $300,000 home in 2010 and then a $300,000 home in 2017. So those are two different homes because home values have increased over the years. But if you had a home that was valued at $300,000 and you were paying a little bit more than someone with that home valued at $300,000 today. And so, and if you look at every other school district that we compare ourselves to, theirs has increased over that same time period on that same market value of home. So over this 8-year period, we've gone from among the highest school property taxes to being below the average. In most of these, I stated that voters have approved tax increases in the other districts, either operating referendum increases, capital project levies, which are also considered a tech levy, and building bonds. And then, so for other districts, it's increased an average of $192 per year over that same period, and ours has decreased $48.
One back, I think, Julie.
That's the one that doesn't want to load.
Well, then I'll go ahead because I believe you have this in your packet, and I'll help the community members who are watching. In addition to providing direction on the scope of the projects as well as the operating levy, the board members have also discussed ballot questions and the options that that you have for questions that will be put on the ballot. So really, we came down to at the last board work session talking about two different options. And if we had the slide, you'd be able to see those on your slide. Option A, or one of the options, is for there to be three questions. First of all, a question on the renewal of our current operating levy. That would indicate to our community members that there's no tax increase on that. A second question would be about the bond referendum. And then a third question could be about an increase of levy to operate those new facilities. We also talked at the last board work session about that third question could have an inflationary increase or not. And at least at the point of the last work session, board members were considering not having an inflationary increase to that. So that's one option, is having three questions on the ballot. The second option really is having two questions on the ballot, a question about the bond, and then a question asking voters to revoke and replace the operating. So there wouldn't be a renewal on that. It would be revoking what currently is being paid in the operating and replacing it with current and the additional that Julie just talked about. So we'll be coming back at the July 24th work session, as the board directed us, with some draft ballot language for consideration, and the board will provide direction on what you'd like to do with that. The other conversation that we also started and will continue to develop is what will happen if there's an unsuccessful referendum, and some of the beginning conversations that we've had, we will need to implement in 2018-19 elementary boundary changes. At that time, we'll also have to take a look at school start times and transportation changes, which would go in conjunction with those boundary changes. Class sizes would continue to increase as we run out of classroom space, even with those boundary changes that would happen. And then we would still need to, if we didn't have the operating renewal passed, if that either failed or we asked the question about the revoke and replace, we would need to go out in November of 2018 for the operating renewal. So again, just starting to talk about those conversations, and certainly the board has a lot more work to do around that, but wanted to share that at this time. So as we said, we wanted to provide an update to the community and a review with board members who have spent many hours coming to consensus on the scope of the project and consideration for the increase in operating as well. As I said, later this evening, we will be seeking approval on the review and comment, which lays out really the scope of that bond project. Nothing about the operating, but the scope of the bond project that needs to be submitted to MDE. Any questions at all?
Any comments on the process or any clarifying questions?
I have a quick question. When is it due to the MDE?
What we heard from MDE, we are ahead of the due date, and I don't have the sheet in front of me with it, but they said because there will be many schools that will be going out this year, getting it in this July, getting it approved in at this date would be far better than waiting until August. But I can't remember exactly how many dates out we have to get it there.
What is their time? Do they have a time frame for how long it takes them to approve normally?
60 days. Yeah.
Okay.
So that's kind of as we backward mapped all the work this summer, we were looking at the state.
Any other questions? Comments? Seeing none, thank you. Next on the agenda is the facilities use fee approval, and presenting for us this evening is District Facility Coordinator Gina Fern.
Good evening, everybody. I'm just here to, as we proposed on the board workshop, we reviewed some of the fee increases we talked about for facility use and rental, and you should have a copy of those proposed increases in front of you. I'd be happy to have answer any further questions if you have anything else. Otherwise, I'd like to seek for board approval of those fee increases.
And that's this document you're talking about?
Yep.
Okay. First of all,
in the prior packet, when it was the workshop, there was kind of a comparison from all the other districts and what our different or what the average is and our difference, and then the proposed increase on those. And these would basically, what I'm suggesting for increases would bring us closer to average. In some cases, those fees were, you know, to get to the average, were over a $10 fee hike, so I didn't give that full increase. We just did half of it, and we'll review again next year, because a $10 increase could have a big impact on some of our user groups.
With that, do I have a motion to accept the new facility use fee schedule?
So made.
By Stacy, do I have a second?
Second.
By Lee, are there any questions or comments?
I just want to thank Gina for her work on this. She does this diligently, I believe, almost every year. Is that right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, and always trying to keep us, you know, in line. And I think also, you know, also being concerned about the priority too, which is our own residents, has always been a focus too. So I appreciate that and the effort. So thank you.
And I was going to echo the same. You do a great job with trying to keep everybody happy, and it's not easy, I'm sure. I've been on the other end of it, and I see what you do, so thank you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
I have a question. Can you review for us again the priority 1, 2, 3, and 4, those
priority
definitions?
Priority 1 is basically school programs, and it's, you know, if we have elections or caucuses or stuff like that, that's also considered priority 1. Priority 2 is our nonprofit district youth. Priority 3 is our nonprofit district community adult programs. and priority four is out of district or for profit.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? That passes 7-0.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We move on to new business, the co-curricular staffing survey results and participation reports for the spring of 2017. This is a report only, presented by Activities Director Mr. Reese.
Good evening, members of the board. Thank you very much for having me tonight. Just going to celebrate some of our spring accomplishments, give you some insights into the co-curricular world at Prior Lake High School. This is the third time I've started with this slide. It's just another reminder that we are an education-based program. We believe fully that we're an extension of the school day, and that we use our platform for teaching life lessons to our athletes and our students in our fine art programs. A little bit different than the youth sport programs and our college programs right now. That's Laker acronym right now is something we're using as a reminder for our coaches and our athletes, as well as our parents, in regards to the work we're doing with performance character and moral character. And when we see our students representing any one of these 10 things, we remind them that that's what it means to be a Laker. And it's gone extremely well. It's something we're going to continue to build on next year. But we hope that these are the types of things our students will leave our programs with, and how we're really determining success 20 years down the road when something our coaches did or said made an impact on our students as future adults and citizens in our community. So it's been fun to be a part of. Some participation numbers for you. This is the highest our numbers have been for spring participation. I was able to go back the 7 years that Director Rodine was here and looked at his numbers. We were particularly high in boys track and field. Their numbers went up by almost 60 athletes this spring. But I went through kind of a year review for you. We had 670 students involved in the fall. Our winter is the largest because our fine arts kids are lumped in those numbers, but it does not include our band and choir students. And then we had 670 students involved this spring. But that also doesn't include our independent provider programs, and it doesn't include our student-led clubs. So 2,603 students were involved in a co-curricular, and it's many more than that. Actually, it's just over 80% of our total student body, but I'll get to that in a second. These are all the additional programs that we're currently offering above and beyond what the State High School League mandates that we offer. The independent provider programs are programs within our community that we partner with. The athletes earn a letter award through our district. But the majority of the administration and all of the financing is with those programs. We just partner with them to provide space and an opportunity for our kids to letter, and then they use our high school name. So that's been very popular, and those programs are growing. Programs like rugby, ultimate frisbee, mountain biking, and the fishing team have exploded. And our students are proud to be a part of those programs, and it's connecting them to what's going on during the school day. And I see their t-shirts in the hallway and their sweatshirts, and they're hanging out with each other outside of school and the programs. And it's been a very positive thing for Prior Lake as we continue to grow and bust out of our facilities. We also have some school programs that don't always get much notice. We have a lot of students working with our yearbook program. We have a ton of students getting involved with student council and NHS and our LIV program. And obviously our band and choir programs have grown quite a bit over the last 2 years. And we haven't included those in our fine art numbers because there's a lot of duplicates. A lot of our band and choir kids are also in other activities. So we haven't included them in the numbers that I've been sharing with you, but on Infinite Campus we're able to track all of our students. So that's been great. And then we have all the student-led clubs. Those are annual clubs. They'll re-up next year if students are interested in joining or starting those clubs up again. They can also come with new club ideas. we have them fill out an application, and then we make sure that we have an advisor that's willing to supervise a couple days a week for those. But it's been very popular with our students, and something that we're very proud of in the activity office, and I know district-wide as well. And I just thank you for the continued support for all of our program and the additional program that we've been able to offer. So just over 80% of our student body, total student body, was involved in a co-curricular activity. That would be a sport, a fine art, band, choir. It could be a school program, a student-led club, or one of those independent providers I mentioned. And many of our students are involved in more than one. And it really does do quite a bit to connect our students to the school building, give them a sense of pride, give them a reason for coming to school every day that we're proud of. A scoreboard update. We had a successful spring on the scoreboard as well. So we had three conference champions this spring. Boys track and field completed probably their most successful season in school history this year. They won the section title and was one of our three conference award winners. Softball was also conference champions. That's the first time Coach Hafner in 7 years has won that title. They lost to the number one team in state in sections and didn't quite make it onto the state meet, but played extremely well. Then our girls lacrosse team was undefeated in the conference this year. They ended up third in state. Boys lacrosse also made it to the state tournament. And then obviously we had quite a few all-state honors in boys and girls track. Our trap and skeet teams are also one of the top programs in the state and doing well, including more of our female students going out for trap and skeet, which I know they're very pleased with. Our survey results came back very positive. So we do a scale of 1 to 4. And we ask questions like, did your coach treat you with respect? Did they reward effort, not just results? Did they help you bounce back from mistakes? Did they encourage you to do your best? Did they listen? Those are the types of questions we're asking for feedback from both our athletes and our parents. And the majority of those responses are agree or strongly agree. The average score is somewhere between 3.2 and 3.5 in those responses. We had 102 parent responses for just the spring survey. We sent quite a few out. So our response is still not where we'd like it to be. But of the 102, the surveys came back very positive. That's all I have for you tonight, unless there's any questions regarding co-curricular activities that I can help answer for you.
All right.
I actually have a couple. One is, I didn't see girls lacrosse on your chart for participation.
Let's go back. Did I miss them? Good eye, Lee. That's a really good.
Well, it's girls.
So I'd have to go in and look at those numbers. They have one less level than the boys.
Okay.
So it's probably around 18 to 20 less athletes. So it's somewhere in the 60s. But that would actually increase our spring numbers as well.
Okay. And then are there any plans for any intramural spring sports? Or are there some now?
We have really pushed the ultimate frisbee piece as the independent provider, as well as rugby and trap shooting and the fishing club have really picked up a lot of those numbers.
Okay.
There's an opportunity for like an intramural volleyball, but right now our adapted softball team is housed at the high school in the spring.
Okay, so space is an issue.
So space is an issue with intramurals.
Okay.
But we're still looking at adding intramural dance next year. We'd like to get badminton and grow our table tennis program, and obviously we'll still have intramural basketball coming back. And as kids come up with ideas, we'll continue to try to vet those out. I know kids have come up with archery and disc golf as possible opportunities for intramural programs as well.
Okay. And just one other comment. I appreciate your listing all the additional programming because I haven't seen this very much, so appreciate that. Thank you.
No problem. My pleasure.
I've got a question. And a comment, too. First of all, I've heard excellent things about the Ultimate Frisbee.
Good.
the kids are really loving that one, and the parents like it, too. So.
That's Brian Olson, one of our science teachers at the high school, does a nice job.
They're talking very, very highly of it. One of the questions that I had when I see the student clubs and knowing how, or any of the sports programs for that matter, you know, how important that is to the overall development of these kids. And I was wondering, how do PSEO students actually, especially with the push for a lot of kids wanting to go to decrease the cost of tuition, How do they get involved in this stuff, or can they?
Sure they can. Our SAD club, Students Against Destructive Decisions, were both PSEO, full-time PSEO students that ran the club. So their recruitment is a little bit more difficult. They have to be creative with how they recruit, but we are leveraging things like Schoology and social media to try to get kids interested. And all they really need to do to lead those student-led clubs is be there after school. And what's interesting is with the PSEO kids, there's some flexibility in scheduling. Some days they don't have class at Normandale or wherever they're attending, and they can get in and do more during the lunch hour and do more in the hallways and try to get kids interested in joining the club. So they make it work. But yes, we do have PSEO kids that get involved in our co-curriculars and our student-led clubs.
Any other questions? I have one. Is fishing new this year?
Fishing was added last year as an independent provider.
Okay, because I read about it in the outdoor section of the Star Tribune. Had a very nice article about it. So.
And every boat has to have an adult volunteer, and the volunteers in our community have done an amazing job providing an opportunity for our students. So it's usually one adult for every two students that want to learn or compete in the fishing on the weekends, and it's been super popular. Our kids can't stop talking about how much fun they're having.
Thank you. All right, with that was just a report only and no vote is needed. Next on the agenda is the approval of the review and comment according to Minnesota Statute 123B.71, review and comment for school district construction. That will be presented tonight for review, and board approval of the review and comment is requested, and presenting tonight is Dr. Stahl.
Thank you very much. As I was discussed during the presentation, part of the presentation, wanted to be sure that the community was aware of the scope of the projects that the board has come to consensus on as we have considered and created the review and comment that goes to the Minnesota Department of Education. This review and comment will supersede the document that was submitted to the department in the spring of 2016. So I'm happy to answer any questions. The full review and comment is in your board packet. Actually, there were two things that I wanted to correct or actually add in the document. Under leased facilities,
what page
it's your
is that on again?
Your page, board packet page 111, page 5 of the review and comment.
Okay, thank you.
We have Bridges Area Learning Center listed as one of the leased facilities. We don't have MNCAPS listed there, so we'll be sure that gets updated before it is submitted. And then also on page 7, 113 of the board packet, the last sentence, that was just a bit of a review on our facilities task force and design team process, and that last sentence should read, options for additional secondary buildings were also evaluated by the community task force, but it was their recommendation to expand existing facilities. So we'll be sure that gets added as well. And that was the conversations about an additional high school. So with that, I will be happy to take any questions, but we are seeking board approval on that so that can be submitted to MDE.
And with that, do I have a motion to accept the review and comment?
So moved.
By Ben, do I have a second?
Second.
By Lee. Any questions or comment? Mary?
Yes, I briefly discussed this, although I put it in writing ahead of time. There's a couple things that I'm still concerned with, and I know we discussed it, but I don't think we discussed it in length. And that was part of the issues with some of the core infrastructure in some of the buildings been moved out to long-term facility maintenance, like the HVAC and the windows and things like that. It concerns me that would be, even though it would be done at the same time, that we'd be paying for it separately, as well as moving it off under a separate project management type of scenario. So could we just briefly discuss this and kind of talk about the impact and how that's going to get handled? I know one of the goals, that I'm very aware of, one of the goals is to bring down the total cost of the referendum, but we still have to pay for it. So I think this needs to be discussed before we actually finalize our review here.
Mr. Gordon has a
several years now for long-term facility maintenance projects. And this includes the previous health and safety and deferred maintenance items, but it also allowed us to do some other things. It gave us more capacity to do these, but also it gave us the capacity to bond for a few things. So we've done that now the last year to complete some projects. So we do have a 10-year plan that we'll be bringing to the board at the end of the month here. And what we'll do is not increase what we projected over the next 10 years for our plan, but we'll shift some items. So we'll shift them so that these projects for the HVAC can be completed at the same time that the Greenwood Elementary School will be worked on, or whatever school that we'll be utilizing those dollars for. So we'll look at our plan, and we'll shift some items, and we'll delay some. But we won't increase the total dollar amount for our long-term facility maintenance expenditures, so that it is included in what we have, and we won't be levying any more than we have previously, so that it can be covered under what we've done.
Yeah, Mr. Dell, why don't you step up to the microphone for us? Why don't you step up?
I'm sorry. Good evening. It also qualifies for 25% state aid, and any project that we did bring forward is follows the definition of deferred maintenance. So it fits in the scope, and we also get 25% state aid for those projects.
Yeah, that's 25% on top of the state aid that we've already asked for our existing long-term facility maintenance?
No, that includes. So as I stated, we'll fit this into what we have, but you know, we do get the 25% currently, and so we'll continue to get that over the next for these projects as well.
And can I just qualify, if we don't take out, for instance, the HVAC, which was the highest dollar value overall of all the individual projects that were taken out of the total value, are we not allowed to take the 25%? Because it's included in the bond?
We would have to identify a project.
Okay.
As part of the 10-year plan.
Okay. So it doesn't matter where it is. We could still potentially identify
it? As long as it qualifies for deferred maintenance,
You
know, it's just a matter of prioritization for the district.
We would not see that same 25% in the bond. So if we were to put it in the bond, we would not get that same state aid as part of the bond.
Okay.
Yeah, funding source is not available. It's only available when you use the long-term facility maintenance. It's basically 25% credit. I mean, I don't know if I should use that.
So project costing us $1 million through long-term maintenance is really costing the district $750,000. If it was put into the bond, it would cost the full
million.
The full million.
Okay.
Yep. Thank you. And that was the, refresh my memory if I'm wrong, that's the intent of the recent law on long-term facilities maintenance, correct?
That is correct.
To allow districts like ours to do those projects instead of to maintain our resources and
that's
our buildings.
That's correct.
Rich.
Go ahead,
and that was a change in the legislature because we did not meet those state statutes 2 years ago.
Right, we did not receive the ALT facilities dollars that other districts with more square footage than we had, and it really depended on the square footage and the age of your buildings, and our school district did not qualify for that funding. And so this is really a great opportunity for our district. They did change that funding so that we now qualify for long-term facility maintenance, which does give us that 25% funding that other districts were getting.
And our four legislatures members were instrumental in pushing that forward because of the age of our buildings.
Yeah.
So. I saw that was already built into the formula, and that's why I was confused. Again, the formula set a maximum of $1.7 million that we would get. It didn't seem to include the extra. It had a cap on it, in other words. It only allows so much, and we're adding to that. So we get 25% off the what's already been declared.
In essence, we're not adding to it because we're shifting some of our projects. So we're not, that's why I said overall, the total amount that we would is the same. Even though we're adding this project to our list, we're taking some other project off the list.
Just delaying it later.
We're not increasing our tax levy.
No. We're just delaying it.
Any other questions?
Well, I just have one comment. Of course, my iPad went dead. On page 143, the dates, I'm not sure they're right. It says construction will commence October of 2016. I think it's based on the old review and comment.
What page?
143. 143 in our packet. Project schedule.
Last sentence.
The very last sentence.
Yep.
Yeah, that does need to change.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Okay. That would have been great.
Any other questions or comments?
No, go ahead. No.
Okay. It's your turn.
No, go ahead. She's got it. I'm ready.
My general comment is that I'd like to see a separation of concerns with long-term facilities maintenance contractors and our referendum actual construction management contractors. And I'd like to see that actually discussed here. Maybe not now, but maybe leaving that off and discussing it at the next study session. So I think it's a discussion point that we really have not had and given feedback now in the surveys and a few other things. I do think it's something that we need to discuss openly and determine what is the best course to ensure this referendum is passed.
I'm not sure what that is, the review and comment.
Because we mentioned the overall program manager on here, and I'd like to see if we couldn't delay that comment and further discuss it.
Doesn't that hold up review and comment?
Sounds like we have some
do you where in the doc, for my clarification, where in the document do you see that?
We're done. Sorry, I gotta find the page. It says it's where the summary occurs with the overall names, the space, and then the program manager.
What page of the document?
I'm paging through it right now. I apologize.
Page 1?
Yeah, it was right at the beginning, so I'm trying to move up, and I've been going a little too fast with my finger here. Yes, on page 1. Well, 106, actually.
Requesting one again for my.
Yeah, I'm requesting us to discuss who the program manager or who the construction manager program manager is going to be and have an open discussion on that in the next study session.
I think we have a signed contract with Nexus for this. I'm confused as to what we'd be trying to
discuss,
change at this point.
There is an out on the contract and it hasn't, and we haven't yet started on this, so I'd like to see if we can't discuss it openly, especially given some of the feedback that we have received so far.
Seems to me we've discussed this openly quite often. It's come up. I'm really not sure what else you want to discuss. I mean, I don't know if it's, I guess it's up to you, Rich, or whoever, but if there's some discussion and we're holding up the review and comment, and we just heard that we need to get it into the state as soon as we can in order to keep our schedule, then maybe we need to discuss whatever you want to discuss now.
I don't know
if the board wants to do that. I don't know if that's.
I don't know
what
if
you mean.
I'm for that.
I'm very confused.
I've been on the board 6 months, and no, I don't believe we have had, in my recollection, an open discussion on this. And I think it does warrant it that we do it. At least, even if we come back to the same conclusion, I do think it's worth a discussion.
I'm not opposed to discussion, but my understanding is I'm new to the board right now too. Mm-hmm. Been on the board before. Admit that. Everybody knows it. But this was voted on before I got on the board. And I believe there was discussion at that time.
Yes, there was numerous discussions.
And it was voted on unanimously, is my understanding, that we would go forward with Nexus. If that's not true, or if there needs to be more discussion about that, I'm not aware of what we discussed, because we're in contract with them, and that's already been approved. So So I'm not sure where we go from here on that.
I understand that, but given the feedback that we've already received and the experiences that I've had just in the first 6 months of me being on the board, that I do think it's worth a discussion. And I think we do need to bring it out in the open. And there is an out on all these contracts, which is a good and bad thing, of course. And we just need to make sure that we are discussing it for the benefit of the community as well as for ourselves. And I, for one, can speak for myself, and I'm not speaking for anybody else here, to say that the experience so far in the first 6 months with regards to this process has not been basically stellar. And I'd like to see some of those issues actually brought out. And I know I've put a lot of things in writing, and I've tried to discuss things individually to try and come to some understanding of the current situation, and it has not gone so well. And I think it's worth a discussion. And again, even if we come back to the same conclusion, I do think it is worthy of an open discussion.
Rich, point of clarification. I think we need to have a motion to make the discussion.
That'd be amending the agenda.
That would be amending the agenda. We could.
That's not the discussion. That's not the. That's not on our agenda. We'd have to add something. Point of order.
I think in order for this, we would have to have a motion to table this action item, would we not?
I don't believe so, because we're talking about the issue right now.
Correct.
No, we're not. We're talking about review and comment. Sorry, Rich.
Go ahead, Lee.
I'm just saying we're talking about the review and comment as to whether we want to send this forward to the state of Minnesota or not. We're not talking about whether we want to use Nexus or anyone else for our consulting project manager. That's not what is on our agenda at this point.
But part of the review and comment, just to make sure that I'm aware here, is that program manager is on there, as well as some other things. So I think this would be an opportune time, if there was a question, to discuss it.
I disagree.
And I would disagree as well. I think it's been asked and answered numerous times. Between July and October of last year, the contract was rewritten and reviewed by our attorneys, and it was voted on and approved by the board.
Ben, do you have any thoughts?
No, I mean, I'm completely confident in Nexus's abilities and what they've both showed, that what they've done and abilities going forward. I think we've exhausted the comments and discussion on the Nexus, quite honestly. I think it's more of a distraction than anything else.
I agree. I think it's more of a distraction than anything else. I think it's a last-ditch effort to try and throw a wrench into our whole project once again. We've seen nothing brought forward where there's been any misgivings, mishandling, or anything of any funds through any bid processes or any contracts we've written with Nexus or handled through Jim or Julie, and I don't see how today this, no one has brought forth anything that has shown any evidence of any misgivings.
And I would also be against opening the discussion, because it would seriously entail our ability to get this into the state of Minnesota on time, and then to actually move forward with the project that's will add needed space for our students. So seeing a consensus of not having that discussion, we will move on. That not seeing a consensus is that's the direction that the board would like to take at this time. So are there any other comments or questions? Seeing none, all those in favor of approving the review and comment for the state of Minnesota signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed say nay.
Nay.
That passes 5-2. Next is the superintendent yearly evaluation. Superintendent Dr. Stallo submitted a goal update for 2016-2017. And the board and administration has completed an online evaluation, and the results have been summarized by the board chair. And the executive board has drafted a public statement, which I will read at this time. It is the opinion of the Prior Lake Savage Area School Board that Dr. Stallo has met and exceeded the expectations in her duties as superintendent of the Prior Lake Savage Area Schools. In the past year, Dr. Stallo has continued to focus on student achievement through strategic directions detailed in the operational plan and priority work. She has positively engaged the community, administration, and our teaching staff with passion and enthusiasm during the implementation of our continuous improvement processes and in providing strategic oversight for our learning and our building teams. We look forward to her continued leadership in order to meet the needs of our growing and innovative district. We thank her for her commitment and energy put forth toward our district and look forward to her future direction of the Prior Lake Savage Area Schools. Have any comments, Dr. Stallo?
I don't. It is a pleasure to serve this fine district and community. Thank you very much for the comments.
Thank you. Next is item 12 on the agenda, policy. The second and final reading of the policies, mandatory policies, will be done at this time. I think they were presented by Mr. Mons at our study session last time. Any additional comments on those? Oh, first of all, why don't I take a motion on whether to approve the final reading of the policies, the mandatory policies laid out in our school board packet.
So moved.
By Lee, do I have a second?
Second.
By Mary, are there any questions or comments? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? That passes 7-0. And item B under policy is the second and final reading for policy 104. I think the agenda has policy 203 listed, but I think there are no changes. Do we have to approve that policy?
No.
On a yearly basis? That was originally going to be edited to remove the changes.
The mission policy, we just hadn't updated it with our newest mission. So right. the only change on that was having our current mission statement on there.
And on policy 203, it has been clarified and that the Prior Lake American and the Savage Pace will now publish our agendas at no charge, so no change in policy will be needed at that time. So do I have a motion for the acceptance of policy 104, updating the mission statement?
So moved.
By Mary, do I have a second? By Lee, any discussion?
By Stacy.
Or by Stacy, thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? That passes 7-0. We move on to administrative reports. Dr. Stallo.
Excellent, thank you. At Prior Lake Savage Area Schools, our mission is to educate all learners to reach their full potential as contributing and productive members of our ever-changing global community. Our collective work is focused on that, and tonight I'd like to highlight some of the work in which we've been engaged. First of all, for the eighth year in a row, Prior Lake Savage Area Schools has won the prestigious Certificate of Excellence in Financial Reporting Award from the Association of School Business Officials International. According to ASBO, Prior Lake Savage Area Schools earned the certificate after providing a high-quality, comprehensive annual financial report for the fiscal year end 2016. The certificate represents the highest standard for financial reporting and is only awarded to school districts that have exceeded the standard of the program. Attainment of the certificate is validation that the district has met the level of excellence required by ASBO and is a testament to the integrity and technical competence of the Prior Lake Savage Area School business staff. Congratulations to Executive Director of Business Services, Julie Sink, along with her staff. And we will be inviting them to a future board meeting so that we can recognize and thank them during Laker Pride. Also, the Green Ribbon, as you know, Edgewood School and Loyola Del Lago have earned a Green Ribbon Schools Award from the United States Department of Education. They will be honored in Washington, D.C., July 18th through the 20th. Ben Hansen will be our school board representative who will help accept the awards. So we look forward to hearing about that. And seeing some great photos as well. And lastly, just a reminder to everyone that Lakefront Music Fest is this weekend, July 14th and 15th at Lakefront Park. This is an annual event put on by the Prior Lake Rotary that benefits nonprofits in our community, including the Laker Athletic Booster Club, the Patrons of the Art, and new this year, our elementary PTCs. So we thank them and look forward to a great event. There are tickets still available. Thank you.
Next is administrative reports. Do we have any administration reports this evening?
I do just want to update a little bit on enrollment, where we're at right now. We last year were about the same place we were last year, about 130 students short of our targeted number. And last year we were about the exact same number. And I kind of looked back and saw that we had 80 students that applied over the last week of July and the first week of August. So that's a busy time for us, so I expect that we'll see that again this year as we move forward. So we're on track. Our kindergarten is on track. As you know, we limited open enrollment to 75, and we have that number right now. But that's about 20 students, or a little bit better than 20 students less than what we had last year because we limited that number. So we are, but we are on target as well.
Okay, thank you. And any board reports? We'll move on to board reports. I will mention that before the meeting, we had a two-hour session on board development, and where the board continues on our continuous process improvement towards board governance. Any other board reports? Seeing none. Item number 14, future events. As Dr. Stallo mentioned, Lakefront Music Fest, July 14th and 15th, one night country, one night rock and roll. And then we have a school board study session on July 24th scheduled.
Chair Wolf, we will be moving into a regular board meeting at the end of that as well. Part of that will be the approval of the long-range facility plan.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. And with that, we move on to item number 15, closed session due to discuss strategy. The meeting will be closed in order to discuss negotiation strategy. Do I have a motion to close the meeting?
So moved.
By Melissa. Do I have a second?
Okay.
Second by Ben. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? That passes 7-0. Meeting is now closed. Thank you.